Welcome everybody here at this geopolitical lecture on current affairs of Russia, here in the audience and also in the live stream at home. My name is Willem Scholte. I work for Studium Generale, Department of the Erasmus University that organizes lectures, debates, cultural events and talk show. And we do so to broaden one's cultural and academic horizon. And we're very happy that you're here all today. Before I start the introduction of today, some practicalities. First, please note that this lecture will be recorded and live streamed. The camera is pointed to the lecturer, so you won't be in view. But be aware when you ask a question afterwards that your voice will be recorded. And also, there is a photographer of Erasmus University here. If you don't want to be on the picture, please be so kind to tell him when you see him afterwards. The lecture will take around 45-50 minutes, and after that there is plenty of room for discussion. Please wait until you receive the microphone, because otherwise people, especially at home, can't hear you. So now back to today's topic. I think Russia is all over the news. 3 weeks ago, United Russia won the parliamentary elections, stained by fraud claims. You probably have seen the kind of weird videos of big piles of voting paper dumped in the ballot boxes. And last week, hundreds of videos were leaked with torture and sexual abuse from prisoners. And even as we speak now, Russian cosmonauts, that's something completely different, are filming the first motion picture in space ever, thus winning the rat race with, in this matter, US. So I can go on and on. I mean, are we heading for a new Cold War? Will be there any room for domestic opposition like what it used to be in a democracy? And where is Russia going under the leadership of Putin? To answer some of these questions, I'm very happy that Laura Staring is here today with us. She will shine a light on this enormous country with even maybe a bigger sphere of influence. She will look back at the past, at least the past few years, and looks ahead what is probably coming up. Laura Staring is Slavic and Russia expert. She's a journalist and co-founder of Raam op Rusland, Window to Russia, to translate. It's a knowledge platform about society, culture, and history of Russia and its former satellites. And it is a partner of both the Klingendaal Institute and Leiden University. She worked for 30 years or even more for quality newspaper NRC Handelsblad. And as a correspondent, she won the Anna Vondeling Award for her correspondence in Moscow. And besides all these things, she's also a very acclaimed author of well-received books about Russia, and I translate again, like Putin's Russia and Mail from Russia. Please, a very warm welcome for Laura Staring.
Thank you very much. I can't see you at all. I hope you see me. I'm very happy to be here because the timing of the lecture, I think, is pretty brilliant. I was asked by Willem to do something, you know, start with the elections or whatever. And then I thought, how boring is that? What can I tell about the Russian elections? Because they were fraudulent, as we have seen all. And then what happened? All of a sudden last week, we had this big news. The Nobel Peace Prize was awarded to Dmitry Muratov, editor-in-chief of the Russian newspaper Novaya Gazeta. And then I thought, you know, this is the best thing to start my lecture with, because it's at least some positive note in a very bleak picture that I'm going to describe to you shortly. Just two words about myself. As Willem said, I'm a Slavicist. When I was your age, I suppose you're probably somewhere around 25. I was studying in Leningrad. That was quite a special time because it was still communist. It was in the Soviet Union. Russia, the Russian Federation didn't exist yet. That was a very weird sensation for a young Western liberal student, live in a student hostel, a student dorm, with people who had to watch you, who had to inform on you. Occasionally you would have a tale when you visited people that they were not happy that you visited. Friends were unhappy to be seen with you because they were scared. So for a politically pretty naive person as I was when I was 25, that was quite a shocking experience. And then big step forward when I was a correspondent for NRC Handelsblad. That also was a very shocking period because I effectively witnessed the end of communism. That was the era of Mikhail Gorbachev, who was, I think, the only decent party leader or leader of the country that Russia has had in the last 100 years. And it was, for a journalist, it was like a gold mine to be able to witness the demise of this communist system that was hated by the population. We journalists had never expected that it would end that soon and that we could witness it all. So as Willem said, 5 years ago, I started the website Raam op Rusland. That was in the wake of the Ukraine crisis, because we three former correspondents in Moscow of two Dutch newspapers, we realized that we don't know enough about Russia because nobody had seen it coming. The annexation of Crimea, the war in the Donbas, it all seemed so improbable in the heart of Europe, that we decided that it's time to start beefing up the knowledge and information about Russia that doesn't make it to the newspapers. That's why we started. Well, that's 5 years ago. And when I was in Moscow in those years, in the beginning of Raam op Rusland, I was amazed because the difference with the time that I had been there as a correspondent was huge. Moscow had completely transformed into a modern metropole. In the time that I was working there, there were queues for every food product. It was bleak, it was dark, it was poor, it was downtrodden. People were scared, people were somber and negative about everything. And nowadays, Moscow is a blossoming town. You can get anything in any shop what you want. So still, every time that I go there, I'm shocked because I still remember it very well, how it was before. But to be honest, the last 2 years have been pretty depressing report on for our website, as the situation is deteriorating rapidly. And you wouldn't say that if you walk the streets of Moscow, because it still is a beautiful town, a beautiful city, a capital, a metropole, and everything is there, and people look good and well-fed and well. Where they have the modern clothes that you can imagine, et cetera, et cetera. But underneath that, you feel that the fear is returning. And I know what I'm talking about because I remember that fear from the 70s and 80s when I visited the Soviet Union. Then let's go to this guy, Dmitry Muratov. Because what happened last week, all of a sudden, out of the blue, the editor-in-chief of Novaya Gazeta, an opposition newspaper, was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, together with Maria Ressa, a very famous and threatened journalist from the Philippines, where the situation is even worse than in Russia. Muratov, the Novaya Gazeta was funded with money of another Nobel Prize, Peace Prize, for that was awarded to Gorbachev in 1993. And it's the oldest opposition newspaper in Russia. And so it is very apt and just that this guy got the Nobel Peace Prize. He himself immediately said that the prize was not for him, but for Igor Domnikov, Yuri Shukachikhin, Anna Politkovskaya, Stas Markelov, Anastasia Baburova, Anastasia Estemirova, because all those journalists who worked for his newspaper were killed in the last 15 years. So he considers it rightly as an honor to those people and an honor to the press freedom in Russia that is under severe threat at the moment. Of these people, I knew two. Yuri Shukachikhin was actually a very dear friend of mine. When I was working in Moscow, he was a research journalist working for the Literaturnaya Gazeta, doing very, very brave articles on corruption. And he died a very mysterious death. He was poisoned. In those days, we didn't know what could have been behind that. But nowadays, after the poisoning of Alexei Navalny, we know, and Litvinenko and other examples, we know who probably was behind that. So what happened after the awarding of the Nobel Prize to Muratov was slightly uncomfortable, because Dmitry Peskov, which is the spokesperson of Putin, praised Muratov. We can congratulate Dmitry Muratov is consistently pursuing the ideals which he adheres to. He's talented and brave. Of course, it's a very high appraisal, blah, 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 which is almost a kiss of death for somebody in Russia who is in the opposition. Because if the Kremlin starts praising you, then there must be something wrong with the prize. On the same day, however, the Russian Ministry of Foreign Affairs added 12 new names to the so-called list of the Ministry of Justice of foreign agents, showing by that these words of Peskov are completely ludicrous, because the suppression of the press freedom continues on a daily basis. And I will later explain what it means for a journalist to be designated as a foreign agent. This is to show the braveness of the Novaya Gazeta, for instance. A week after the downing of the MH17 in 2014, they made this front page in Dutch, Vergeef ons Nederland, Prestigalandia. And then, of course, you have to know that the official point of view of the Kremlin is that the Ukrainians downed their own the Dutch plane, and that the Russians have nothing, and there are no Russians at all in the east of Ukraine, and they have nothing to do with the whole situation. So this is the newspaper that was designated, and I think it's very aptly and rightly done. When I was preparing for this talk, I decided that the situation in Russia the last 1.5-2 years changed dramatically, and that all has to do with a couple of circumstances that have struck the Kremlin as especially dangerous for the situation in the country. The first thing that happened was in January 2020, Putin managed through the Duma to change the constitution in a way that he can stay in power till, technically speaking, till 2036. He did that with a very weird trick. He made sure that his former terms, his presidential terms, were annulled. And he motivated that by saying that the situation in the world is so fragile and so unstable that it was necessary for Russia to keep stability, and for that reason to keep him basically in power. Well, so far, so good for the Kremlin. But then in spring, Russia was also struck by COVID, like the rest of the world. And that was, of course, an unpleasant surprise because it deemed very difficult to have a consistent policy towards this pandemic. And the policy of the authorities was very unclear. In the beginning, they said it was a Western problem. They didn't have any problems with the pandemic. So there was no policy at all. So then there was a complete lockdown. Then they invented Sputnik as a vaccine. But the policy of the authorities was all the time very unclear and wavering. The effect of that is that in Russia at the moment they are witnessing the fourth wave of COVID numbers. The numbers are extremely high. It is unclear how many die of COVID because the official statistics are not trustworthy. But it is clear that there is a superfluous mortality rate of about 600,000 that people think probably will be because of COVID. So this for the authorities was an unpleasant surprise because as control freaks as they are, they want to have everything under control, and that with COVID they didn't manage. Well, then the next thing that happened, so that's COVID here, what you see here is Putin in the beginning dressed up like a cosmonaut, was visiting one of the COVID clinics in Moscow. But this is the real picture. This is what hospitals, especially in the provinces, look like. Overcrowded with people and no treatment whatsoever. Not enough oxygen masks, not enough medication, etc., etc. In Russia, for instance in the United States, the policy of the authorities was that the Kremlin stayed aloof, and they put the responsibility on the mayors and the local governors. Like, for instance, this is Sergei Sobyanin. It's the mayor of Moscow, a very powerful man in Russia, and he here is talking with his with doctors about how to manage the pandemic. In October, as I said, the numbers were soaring again. And what you see now is that the statistics go up and up all the time, and there is no end to it. Only 30% of the Russian population took the vaccination, and that has all to do with the fact that Russians don't trust their authorities. So if Putin tells them to vaccinate themselves with Sputnik, then they think, well, we prefer Pfizer, or we would like to have medication from abroad. So that makes the situation very unclear at the moment, and the country is still closed for foreigners. The second unpleasant surprise for the Kremlin after the Putin has had arranged his re-election for the coming second two terms was the massive uprising in Belarus after the fraud on the elections of the 9th of August in 2020. Lukashenko stayed in power, but what nobody had expected, because the Belarusians, they were considered as a very docile people, and never were any big demonstrations like, for instance, in Ukraine. Everybody went to the streets, and enough was enough, and there were massive demonstrations going on. Well, you know the pictures, in Minsk and loads of other towns. And then there came this huge crackdown. On Belarus, I could talk also. It's a separate lecture, but now I will only use it to explain that the massive repression, 10,000s of arrests, torture in prisons, the crushing of media and NGOs. The whole situation was completely unexpected in the heart of Europe. For Putin, it was also a very unpleasant surprise because Belarus is one of the buffer states between West and East, and for Russia, it is a special geopolitical, very important country. So after Ukraine left the geopolitical sphere of influence of Russia, after Maidan, for Putin it was unacceptable that another country would choose that same path. Luckily enough for him, Lukashenko agreed with him and crushed the opposition. This means, of course, that Belarus was thrown into the arms of Russia. There is a so-called union state. There is an agreement between the two countries that they are going to merge in some far future and completely work together in the political field, in the economic field, etc., etc. For the time being, for Russia, one thing was completely clear: a Belarusian scenario with the upcoming elections for the Duma in September of 2021, that was Putin's biggest nightmare. So that was not going to happen. And this has stimulated the repression in Russia in a huge way. And then there was the third thing that was important. This is Maria Kolesnikova. She was one of the three women who were the faces of the demonstrations in Belarus. She's now in prison. She got 12 years of because of treason. These are some pictures of the torture that was being used against demonstrators. Well, the third thing that was a very unpleasant surprise for Putin was that the poison attack with the nerve agent Novichok on the 20th of August of 2020 didn't succeed. Alexei Navalny survived. Well, I don't think that I need to explain to you who Alexei Navalny is. He was the most popular opposition politician in Russia the last couple of years, and the most effective because he was the only one who managed to organize a political opposition group that was on a scale in the whole country. So since 2017, he managed to organize demonstrations in, say, like 100 cities in Russia at the same day, which was huge success and never had happened before. So this organization was really becoming a nuisance to the Kremlin. So something had to be done. Apart from that, Navalny's organization FBK, the Fund for the Struggle, the Fight with Corruption, published YouTube films on a massive scale about corruption of people in the entourage of Putin and also of Putin himself. And those YouTube films were massively watched in Russia. So this was a potential bombshell for the country, for the regime. So that must have been the reason that the authorities decided that they had to get rid of Navalny. Well, then they choose this very, very cynical and sick method to get rid of him. I mean, you could just shoot somebody or get him killed in a car accident or whatever. But for some reason, the Russian authorities prefer to poison people. We have had several examples of that abroad, like Alexander Litvinenko, who was killed in Moscow, in London, and my friend Yuri Shikachikhin, who was killed in Moscow years before. But what happened, he didn't die. So on behalf of Angela Merkel, he was transported. She personally called Putin and said, I want him transported to Berlin, where he can get better treatment. He was transported to Berlin. And miraculously, he survived. This is Navalny with his family. He has two kids and a wife, Yulia. But every normal people after such an attack would probably say, okay, you know, I've had enough. I have only one life and I have a wife and kids. Not Navalny. Navalny decided that outside of Russia, he's nobody. He has to go back. So he decided to take the risk. Well, we know how it ended. He was arrested immediately at the airport, immediately sent to court. In 2 days' time, he was sentenced to 2.5 years of labor camp on the ridiculous charge that as he had an older verdict for so-called fraud in a court case that was considered by the European Court of Human Rights as politically motivated, he was supposed to go to the police every week. Because he was freed on parole. He couldn't do that because he was in coma in Berlin. That didn't play a role. They, on that ridiculous charge, they brought him immediately to the court when he came back to Moscow and put him in jail, where he is now lingering. So the next step, well, after that, there were massive demonstrations to free him. Protesters came to the streets. But with the Belarusian uprising in mind, the authorities decided to crack down immediately. So there were thousands of arrests. People were, the cells were crowded. People were sentenced to draconian prison terms for absolutely nothing, just for taking part in demonstration. What is worse, the authorities decided to prohibit FBK, to get rid of the opposition before the elections. And they they said that FBK was an extremist organization run by terrorists, and that everybody who had anything to do with it was in principle could be brought to justice. And as there were tens of thousands of people who were in one way or another connected to FBK or had taken part in demonstrations organized by Navalny when he was still free. So in principle, all those people were, theoretically speaking, were in danger. That was a very effective method. What didn't help was that FBK made a very stupid mistake. They wanted to organize a very big demonstration for the release of Navalny and started collecting the names and email addresses of the people who said that they wanted to take part, because they wanted to do it all into the open, no hidden agenda. Then, as it happens nowadays, those data were leaked by somebody, which meant that the authorities all of a sudden had a complete database of all the people who were sympathetic to Navalny, which of course is quite scary if you happen to be one of those demonstrators. So FBK was forbidden. There was a new court case against Navalny and his employees for organizing terrorist and extremist organization, and they could get like 10 years for that if it ever comes to court. So most of the people in his surroundings, they left the country. Navalny is in jail. And from outside of the country, they tried, the people of FBK tried to continue to influence the political discussions and to influence the Duma elections. How far the authorities go in putting pressure onto people is, I can give a small example. One of the director of FBK, Ivan Zhdanov, a young guy who fled abroad, he was punished in this way. His father was arrested, and he is now lingering in a labor camp somewhere near Arkhangelsk in the high north. This is pure revenge for the deeds of his son. Because of all that repression, on the 21st of April, when FBK wanted to organize one big last demonstration for the release of Navalny, only few people took to the streets. It was obviously that of the 460,000 people who had given notice that they would take part, only 50,000 or so dared to go out. And there were like 1,700 arrests. So that's about the end of FBK. That was a really a force to reckon with for the Kremlin. Well, in April, what we saw was the start of a media crackdown. Medusa, it's a Russian website that's being made in Riga by a Russian team of journalists who left the country, was designated as a foreign agent. Russia has a law on foreign agents, and if you know a little bit of the history of Russia, then you must understand that for the regular Russian, the stigma foreign agent is a very scary thing, because it remembers people of the Stalin times. In Stalin's time, everybody who had any connection with Russia, with foreigners, was a foreign agent, meaning a traitor, a spy, somebody who had to be executed. So this stigma for journalists is killing. And this what we have seen the last couple of months is that the media landscape has changed dramatically. When we were starting our website Raam op Rusland 5 years ago, and I was trying to get in touch with Russian journalists and trying to interest them to work for us, to because we considered it important that people in Holland would read stories by Russians themselves and not only by Western correspondents, I was struck by the vibrancy and the energy and the high quality of research journalists that I met in Russia. There were several very, very good research groups. One of them very closely cooperated with Bellingcat. I don't know if you know that name, but Bellingcat is a British news data leak organization that played an enormous role, for instance, in finding the culprits of the downing of the MH17, but also participation of Russian forces in the war in the Donbas. Also, they played a tremendous role in the whole poison scandal around Navalny, because they managed, that was really, I don't know if you saw that, but it was amazing. It was they managed Navalny when he was recovering in Berlin. He started cooperating with Bellingcat, and they managed to get a phone number of one of the people who shadowed Navalny and poisoned him. And Navalny tricked him and called him and pretended that he was calling from somebody higher up. And this guy explained everything, that how he had to clean the underwear of Navalny of this Novichok poison, etc., etc. It was a huge hit in Russia, of course. Millions and millions of people watched that video. So Bellingcat, based in Holland, by the way, works with Russian journalists. And for those Russian journalists, that now has become really very, very dangerous. So what we have seen, that the media. No, first I will go to the Duma elections, because it was all this crackdown on the media. I think about 70 Russian journalists now personally are on this hit list of the Ministry of Justice, designated as foreign agents. An organization like Medusa could not being designated as a foreign agent meant that from one day to the other, the complete business model collapsed, because all advertisements disappeared, because everybody was scared to have anything to do with them. And apart from that, they work, of course, with Russian journalists. And for the Russian journalists, it's dangerous to work for an organization that has this stigma. So it became more and more difficult to work. This crackdown that took place mostly this summer was all meant, you know, to clear the field before the Duma elections of the 17 till 19 of September, where you see here the pictures of the counting of the voices. From abroad, FBK still tried to influence the elections, and for that they had a strategic tool which is called Umnoye Golosovanie, which means smart voting. And the strategy behind it was thought out by Navalny when he was not in prison yet, was that United Russia, the Kremlin party that was sure to win the elections, was so powerful, and there would be so massive fraud that other political parties were hardly allowed to do any campaigning, or were forbidden, or were persecuted. So the FBK people said, what you should do is vote on anybody, not on anybody of United Russia. So, and they had an app. They installed an app, and you could check when you were in the voting. When you were planning to cast your vote, then you could check on the app, in your precinct, what was a safe person that you could vote for. As long as it was not a candidate for United Russia. But because of the crackdown, because of the repression, because of the terminology that was being chosen, foreign agents, treason, terrorism, etc., etc., this system didn't work at all. It collapsed completely. It didn't play any role during the elections. Apart from that, the NGOs were shut down. This is an NGO called Golos, which means voice, and they sent observers to the polling booths to check if everything goes well, and they would report on every fraudulent situation that they would witness. They were also designated as foreign agents. So, exit Golos. This is a very funny but also pretty horrible way of cheating during the elections. In Petersburg there was a candidate who was called Wisniewski, and all of a sudden it appeared that there were three Wisniewskis. So to to cheat on people that they didn't know who. So smart voting, they were supposed to vote for this Wisniewski, but then there were two other Wisniewskis on the posters, and they didn't know which one was the right one. So they went at great lengths to cheat on people. Then just before the elections, there was still a major blow to FBK, which was that this app, the Russian authorities put pressure on Google, YouTube, and Apple, and said you are not allowed to sell this app for smart voting in your app shop, because it is interfering into our elections. So they caved into that pressure, and the app was kicked out of the app shop. And then there was also this guy, Pavel Durov. He is very famous in Russia. He is the CEO of Telegram, which is a very, very big chat service in Russia, Russian. So almost all Russians use it. And he fled the country already a couple of years ago when he had problems with the authorities. But the service is still used heavily in Russia, and he also caved in and kicked out the smart voting app. So all in all, then, yeah, we have, when you have hardly any people who observe the elections, when the state television doesn't cover opposition politicians, it is very difficult to follow what's going on. There were the YouTube films of the pictures from the cameras that are in the booth in the voting booths, and they are really very funny. I can't show them, alas, but I suppose you have seen them, because when you see people stuffing extra bulletins into the voting box, and people standing taking big bunches of votes out of their jackets, and so it was a big mess. And we have one statistician who is called Sergei Shpilkin, and he is already following on the Russian elections for a very, very long time. And there were irregularities like this one, that you see that all of a sudden people change their minds, and all of a sudden, you know, the votes for United Russia, they climb sky, they rocket sky high, and the other parties go down. And this was then there was another way of cheating on with the elections, that was e-voting. For the first time, that was because of Corona, they had installed e-voting. People could vote electronically for 3 days, and that, as everybody said, is a huge possibility for fraud. And what happened, for instance, these two slides show that in the on the left you see this is Moscow, all the precincts in Moscow, and eventually there was a big amount of votes for opposition candidates, the smart voting candidates, so to say. And then the electronic voting was over, but for 14 hours there were no results in Moscow, which is really weird, because electronic voting, the charm of it is that you push on the button and then you know what it is. But for 14 hours, the authorities were silent, and then all of a sudden, the picture completely changed. So United Russia won everywhere. So, yeah, these are the films, but I can't show them. So in the end, it ended up all with this bleak picture. United Russia won almost all the votes in parliament, and the authorities went to great length to get to this result, which is weird, because if they wouldn't have cheated so much, United Russia would have won also. Now going back shortly to the crackdown of the media, what does it mean to be a foreign agent in Russia? This lady, Sonja Groisman, this is like 27 years old. She was a journalist, and she was a very idealistic person, and she was a student with a gold medal and went to the Faculty of Journalism and was very, brave and started working with one of those research groups called Project. And on July the 15th, she got this message that she was labeled as a foreign agent. And what she said, what did that do with her? She said, in the days that followed, it was as if I was attending my own funeral. Everyone around you remembers what a good journalist you were and laments the loss. Only several weeks later did I realize that this was all really happening to me, that the star pupil whom the district was once proud of was one and the same person as the newly cast enemy of the people. So it is as if there is a big void around you of people who don't want to have anything to do with you. You lose all your assignments and practically speaking, it is impossible to work as a journalist. What it looks like is this. And that's really weird because the Ministry of Justice, who checks this list, demands that every news outlet, 5 minutes, that every news outlet has to start every reporting, every post on social media, every single newsreel that they bring with this ridiculous text. You can read it for yourself. It's as if you say, "I am a traitor of my country." So stop reading. This is what it looks like. This is Dorscht. This is a social media post, a Twitter post of Dorscht, which is a famous TV, internet TV station that is also on the list. Every news item they publish, they have to start with this. And it has to be in brackets. It has to be like this. They cannot change a word. So there were, of course, protests. This is one of the journalists that went to the headquarters of the FSB, the secret service in Moscow. One person picket, which the text is "Sami, we ina agenti, you're traitors yourself." There are more. There are more very bad signs. This guy in the middle is one of the most famous lawyers of Russia. He is actually doing a lot of treason cases, and they are the most difficult cases because they're heard under behind closed doors. He fled the country because he was detained, and there was a razzia in his house. He's now in Georgia and tries to work from there. I have so many more things to say. I didn't even go into the curbing of the internet, because what the Russians are trying to do, and that is very scary, is they want to close the internet and create their own so-called RuNet. And a couple of years ago, experts said that's impossible. The Chinese have managed because they never have let the internet reign freely. but the Russians have left the gin out of the bottle and it's not possible to get it back in. But now there are more and more signs that they are managing, they have their own, they're developing their own internet tools and their own devices, and they're blocking and like the example with the smart voting shows, they effectively can put pressure on foreign tech giants to comply to their wishes. So this is becoming a reality, which for Russia would be a disaster, because especially the young generation is completely into internet and is getting all its information on from international sources and from YouTube, etc. I will skip that. I will finish by saying that there were analysts who said, okay, this crackdown, it's understandable. They are scared because of the Belarusian scenario, so they wanted to show that, you know, this is not going to happen in Russia. It was because of the elections, and after the elections, there will be relaxation and everything will calm down. There are no signs of that. Every week there are new journalists added to the foreign agent list. Every week there are more treason cases. The FSB, Secret Service, recently published a new list of military secrets. And to give just one more example of an ominous sign, last week, the 35-year-old CEO of a cybersecurity firm called Group IB, he's called Ilya Sachkov, he was arrested on treason charges. And probably the reason they arrested him was that he, in an opinion article, he said that if Russia is serious about cleaning up the hacker mess and taking to heart cybersecurity in the country, they have to start cleaning their own country first. And he criticized the apparent immunity of hackers in Russia. As we all know, Russian secret services very often use criminal hacker groups, Russian criminal hacker groups, to interfere in elections in other countries, or to disturb internet services, or to attack other authorities. So this young guy, he's a bright young successful internet guru, you could say, in Russia, is now being tried behind closed doors for treason, and he could get up to 20 years of imprisonment, which will send a shockwave through the internet savvy young generation. A week after the elections, Navalny was designated as an extremist again, and they said that they are going to open up a new court case against him, which means that it is very likely that Navalny will stay in jail indefinitely, like Khodorkovsky did, the CEO of Yukos, who opposed Putin and was jailed for 10 years for that. So in Moscow, the Nobel Prize for Muratov, as is always the case in Russia, there was a big scandal around it, because there were a lot of people, especially the FBK people, who were under severe pressure, who were very angry that the Nobel Prize Committee decided on this compromise and did not give the prize to Navalny. However, I think Muratov deserves the prize, and it is a very good sign that they choose press freedom as the most threatened civil right in Russia at the moment. And Navalny, very elegantly and gallantly out of prison today, sent a message of congratulations to Muratov and said that he was very proud that the prize went to a Russian journalist, and rightly so. If this is going to help, I doubt it. Yeah, I think I have to stop. This is it.
Thank you very much, Laura. Could you maybe elaborate a little bit on what Navalny's ideas are? Where does he want to go with Russia?
Navalny has gone has developed from a, I would say, rather nationalistic politician. He's 45 now. He has been in politics already for about 20 years, 20, 25 years. And when he started, he was a very nationalistic and maybe even xenophobic Russian politician. He has evolved. That has to do with the fact that he was a person who didn't travel. He was inside of Russia most of the time, so it was, you could say, in a way, very Russian. So when this situation around the Novichok poisoning evolved, there were a lot of stories about his past, that he had wrong ideas, that he had said about Caucasians that they were stupid people, that they should be kicked out of the country, etc., etc. He has distanced himself of these opinions, and I think that the his development in he was for instance the it is difficult to judge a politician in Russia. You always have to know what he thinks about Crimea, for instance, because Crimea is a kind of lakmus proof. I don't know how you say that in English. It's a kind of check if he's okay or not. So Navalny's position on Crimea, on the annexation, is that it was wrong, and the war is even worse, the war in the Donbas. But as Crimea now is Russian, it is impossible to give it back, because we told the people who live there, we gave them Russian passports, we told them that they were Russian citizens, and by giving them back to Ukraine now, that would deteriorate their situation, because they would become second-rate citizens in Ukraine again. So he's, in that way, he's pragmatic. He says, it was wrong, but you cannot undo it. Some things you can't undo. He also changed a lot, I think, because of his visit to his stay in Berlin. I read there was a huge interview with him in Der Spiegel when he came to his senses, and Merkel was one of the first who came to visit him in the hospital, and he was completely flabbergasted by that, because he couldn't imagine, you know, you cannot imagine, you come from a country where the president has ordered your assassination. You go to a country that has, in principle, no responsibility for you at all, and then the Bundeskanzler comes over and sits, just like a normal person, sits next to you and asks how you're doing. So he was tremendously grateful and shocked by, you know, the difference in attitude between the Russian authorities and Merkel. So I think he evolved. But I wouldn't call him he's not a Western Democrat, in no way, no.
Are there any questions in the audience, please?
Hi, thank you for your talk. So I get that there is a lot of a crackdown on the media, and a lot of things going wrong right now with the elections, fraud, etc. But could you maybe elaborate a little bit on why all of this is happening now? I don't know. I didn't really get that from your talk. Why is Putin so paranoid right now? Like what's going on?
Well, I think
and
that
should we be scared?
I try to explain that actually. In the first place, he in the beginning of 2020, he thought that he had settled it all by changing the constitution, making it possible to stay in power for at least another two terms. That meant for him that meant political stability is saved. And then things started to change. As I said, you had COVID, which was unpredictable. You had Belarus, which was unpredictable. And you had there is a growing gap between the older generation and young people. There is an independent opinion poller in Moscow called the Levada Center, and they recently polled. They keep polling the popularity of Putin, and what you see is that the popularity amongst young people, of course, is going down very rapidly. So most young people want to get rid of him because they are the modern generation. They are internet savvy. They want to travel. They want to live in a normal country. They don't want. They don't buy the political ideology of the Kremlin, which is making. Which is returning to the old KGB style paranoid terminology like treason. I mean, last couple of years, 110 people in Russia have been tried for treason. Most of them were scientists who did military research. So there is this idea of the whole world is against Russia. We are surrounded by enemies. We have to be on our own, and this doesn't appeal to younger people. They want to travel. They want to study. They want to go abroad. They want to have a normal life. And what you saw is that in 2014, when the Ukraine crisis erupted. That was the time that that was, I think, the last time probably that it. The Kremlin managed to make people enthusiastic about this military adventure, because everybody considered Crimea is Russian. You know, we have to have it back, and we are a big country. We are a superpower again, and you must understand that for a lot of people, the end of communism. Was a disaster. It was not only economically speaking a disaster, but also there was this complex of inferiority. All of a sudden, this big superpower was on its knees, and Putin managed to get it on its feet again. So you saw that in 2014, but that atmosphere of euphoria because of this very bold deed of Putin, that has ebbed away, and especially younger people who see. There is nobody in Russia who wants to go back to Roulette. So there is a big distance between the older generation, who watches the state television and gets the propaganda and takes that for granted, and the younger generation that is behaving like normal people. And wants to have a decent life, and I think that in the Kremlin they know that, and they've decided to stop it.
Thank you for your speech today. I was wondering, do you think that the current media repression in Russia by the Kremlin is more of a calculated attempt for? The expansion of its power, or just a sloppy attempt to counter opposition and rising opposition right now?
Well, it's I think it's both. I mean, it's meant to Putin is a control freak. It is for him, obviously, it's very difficult to accept people who want to change the power situation in Russia, which is understandably because, you know, where should he go if he has to leave? There's no place he can go. So the best thing you can do is keep things as they are. And what is the difference between? I lived in the Soviet Union, and then there was only party propaganda. So there was only one story. The difference now is that there are lots of stories, and that is mainly because of internet. And in the beginning after the collapse of communism, there was a complete press freedom. So people became used to different opinions, and a journalistic elite grew up. And the authorities then thought that, you know, that's no problem because they are read by only a small minority of the people. As long as you have the bigger picture on the state media under control, then it is no problem to have internet sites that have their own pieces of information or they cater to their own audience, etc. But more and more, I mean, Navalny was the first who, because of his films on YouTube, that was also one of the things that angered the Kremlin tremendously. When he came back to Moscow and was arrested immediately, the first thing he did was he published this YouTube film about the Putin's palace in Gelendzhik to show that Putin was corrupt. And that was so blatantly unacceptable that film was watched by Russians, by 100 million Russians, you know, so it became too big, it became too obvious for everybody, and because of that the popularity of Putin is going down, so he's trying to counter that situation. But of course there are lots of people in Russia who say that it's a matter of time, he will have to leave. He can't live with the situation that there is an end to his reign and that the country has to change if it wants to, it has to modernize. There are lots of Russian intellectuals who think that that still is possible. But this crackdown shows that, I remember 15 years ago, when I was in Russia doing research for a book I was writing, I spoke a lot to a very well-known dissident called Ludmila Alexeyeva. She was by then 85, and she said, "Laura, you have to be patient. It's gonna take time before we are a modern, civilized country, but it will come." And I said, "Okay, how long does it take?" And then she said 15 years. That's 15 years ago. And what do we see? We see another round of crackdowns, suppression. I'm pretty pessimistic, I must say, about the situation at the moment. I don't see any... there is also a brain drain. Lots of students, young people, people who can get away, they try to get away. They're shooting themselves in the foot. It might end up in a real dictatorship. It's not a dictatorship at the moment. I mean, you can leave, you can speak, you can write. Everything is published. But it's a big step in the wrong direction.
You talk about the crackdown on the democracy. However, do you actually think democracy is the right way for Russia? I mean, Montesquieu argues that different political systems are suited for different countries, especially for big countries, and with Russia not having a civic society, do you think it would be the right way, especially taking into account that the biggest opposition are the communists and then the socialists? I don't think they would be better off with that. and also kind of.
Yeah, that's that I could talk about that for about an hour. That's a big discussion in Russia, of course, also because what you have to bear in the first place, our democracy is under threat as well. I mean, what we have seen, what happened in America, for instance. I mean, we now know that we have to be. We are not the example anymore for anybody, I think, in the world. We have thought that for a long time. In Russia, of course, after the collapse of communism, a lot of people thought, you know, now we're going to have the paradise, the Western society. We will be rich, we will be free, we will be happy. Well, that didn't materialize. And of course, a lot of people in Russia were very disappointed about what we promised them or what they thought that we promised them. And our example didn't work. It didn't work out in Russia for reason of corruption, for reason of mentality, but also for the simple fact that there was no political system. I mean, when the Communist Party collapsed, there was a void, there was nothing, there was no political system. So they had to start organizing that from scratch. There was nothing. And that's impossible. I mean, the political systems, the Western democracies, it took them centuries to grow and to develop. And the big problem for Russia and the Soviet space, of course, was that they didn't have any time to develop a normal situation. So what happened was that basically a political system was invented from high up. There were loads of fake political parties. The Kremlin invested heavily into political parties, with congresses, with programs, etc. But the population, for the population, it didn't make much difference. They thought, you know, it's politics is bullshit. It's fake, and that is why it is so difficult to get people interested into changing the situation in the country. There is a big apathy amongst people, and that's very understandable. The same holds to the economic collapse after the collapse of communism. I spoke several times to Yegor Gaidar when I was working in Russia. He was the first prime minister under Yeltsin who had to invent a market economy for the whole of the country. It didn't exist. But that was crazy. I mean, it was a crazy idea. But there was no other possibility. So he had to force the market to start functioning in Russia from scratch. But so that was the result was that everybody lost everything. So people became very poor. And so this collapse of communism, and I think the West, if you can reproach the West something, then it's maybe because that we didn't understand that. We didn't understand how deep that trauma was. And that trauma has caused apathy, political apathy, the idea that we cheat as well as they, and there is no difference. So why should you fight for democracy? It's all fake. News is fake. Politicians are fake. So in that way, Russia has been an example for us, I'm afraid, and it's not a good example. I don't know if that's hardly an answer to your question, but it's a big question, and Russians debate about it constantly. There is not a clear answer to that, I think. I think if you speak to young people, they want exactly the same as we want. They want to have a decent job, freedom, family, traveling. I don't see, if I speak to Russians, to young Russians, I don't see any difference between them and me or my generation or my generation of my son. So it's not. I think it's not for us to judge how they should live. They have to decide, but it is a difficult decision.
Another question.
Yes, first of all, I would also like to thank you for your talk. I have a bit of a question about something which we didn't really, I think, talk about that much, and I don't know if you can answer it still in the time which we have. But
can you speak a bit louder?
Mm-hmm. So I was just wanted to ask something which we didn't really have a chance to talk about yet, but I thought maybe you can still give a short answer to that. So I'm just very curious because Putin, after the Soviet Union collapsed, said that this was the greatest geopolitical catastrophe of the last century. And often you have the impression nowadays that Russia feels scared because of the extension of NATO to the east, that where there used to be buffer states between them and the West and NATO, there are now actually more NATO partners. And some people in the NATO are afraid that Putin might have aggressive foreign policies towards states like the Baltic states, where we would see similar things happened at the Crimea, that suddenly there's some influence from people who are obviously Russian and you don't know where they come from. Are they from the Russian government? What are they doing there? Whether you think something similar could also happen in the Baltic states or other states which used to be under Soviet influence?
Yeah, well, journalists are not supposed to prophesy. So I mean, nobody had expected Crimea, which was maybe stupid on our part. At the moment, I don't see any threats for other countries. The only country is Belarus. But what you see in Belarus is that the authorities, Lukashenko and his cronies, that they side with Putin. So they can just decide to deliver. Basically, Lukashenko hijacked his country, and he basically can give it to Russia if he wants. Tomorrow, he can give it to Russia, and he will probably. And that is, I'm pretty sure that most of the Belarusian people don't want that. I think that the situation in Ukraine, when the European Union was offering an association agreement to Ukraine, I spoke about that with people in Brussels, and I asked them, why did you do it? And they said, we thought we never ever are we going to take them into the European Union. This is a corrupt country. We don't want them. So let's give them an association agreement because it's harmless. Well, we see what happened. I mean, it exploded into our face. Nobody had expected that the Ukrainians would take to the streets and that they would fight. And so the situation now has changed in that way that for Belarus, everybody is very concerned and Tikhanovskaya is a great person and she's a president and she's being received everywhere and there are sanctions and things. But nobody seriously thinks about, meddling into that, into the situation there, because that's really dangerous. If we would, after Ukraine, take over Belarus, then we might end up with a war. And to be honest, that war might come anyhow. I don't know if you remember, but in spring there were huge military exercises near the Ukrainian border. That was really scary. Because why do they do that? On the one hand, you can say, okay, there are all kinds of geopolitical answers to such questions. You can say, yeah, it's because Biden is new to the bloc and Putin has to show him, if ever you come near to Ukraine, I'm gonna start fighting. Three weeks ago, there was this huge military training in Belarus and also in Russia called Zapad 21. They do that every year, but this year it was extremely big. And there are analysts who say what you see is that they are encircling Ukraine. So it's the Russian side is heavily militarized, the Crimea is heavily militarized, Now they have the Belarusian part is also part of Russia, so they can just close it down. I don't know. I'm not a military analyst. I cannot judge those kind of scenarios, but I'm pretty sure that at NATO they are pretty concerned about these kind of, because the amount of the army, you must realize that after Putin, the Minister of Defense, Sergei Shoigu, is the most popular person in Russia. Militarization of the country, after the collapse of communism, the ex-Soviet army was completely blown away. The last couple of years, they have remilitarized in an extremely efficient way. I don't know, why do they do that? They do that because they feel threatened. Okay, that's possible. But do they have also offensive aims? I don't know. I can't answer that question. I only remember that when Crimea took place, I was in the Baltics. People were scared to death. They were really, and that's one of the reasons why now Lithuania plays such a big role in supporting the Belarusian opposition very bravely, because, you know, Putin can squash them like this, you know. It's one couple of tanks and that's about it. But I have no answers to these questions. No.
Thank you anyway. Yeah.
Yes, thank you very much for your talk. I was wondering whether you can tell something about the state of academic freedom in Russia, because I can imagine it's under similar pressures as freedom of press, and whether there's also opposition movements.
Today I spoke to a colleague of mine who was who just returned from Moscow, and he was present at a conference, a scientific conference of history teachers, about the way history should be treated at schools. And he said that on beforehand he was told which topics were not supposed to be touched upon. Today, as we speak, the rector of the Shaninka, which is one of, you have a couple of very high-profile liberal scientific institutions in Moscow. Shaninka is one of them, and the Vyshka, the higher economic school, is another. Both of them have been attacked by the authorities. The rector has been arrested. Officially, on charges that have nothing to do with freedom of science or whatever, but he is supposed to be enmeshed in a fraud case. But that is the problem with, I mean, Russia's not, there is no rule of law in Russia. So people usually are not, with the exception of now the media and FBK, are not persecuted because of their freedom of speech, but there's always an excuse that you can arrest somebody for. And that's what makes the situation so scary. I mean, the example I gave of this Mr. Sachkov, who is now in jail because they say that officially it's a fraud case. Everybody says it's because he was critical about the attitude towards hacking in Russia. So what you see is the higher economic school in Moscow has had lots of problems the last 2 years with scientific freedom. In 2019, when there were big demonstrations in Moscow because there were local elections, lots of students of the higher economic school took part, and they had political meetings in the school, and that was immediately cut off. It was forbidden. Some scientists, some teachers were fired, were sacked. So there is also, and then there is a specific niche of scientists, so scientists who, so historians are a problem because history is a toxic subject in Russia, as you know, and also people who are working on military affairs. They are under heavily threat at the moment. If you're a Slavicist like me, or you're a mathematician, or so, then you can work. But that was the same in the Soviet Union. Then you could, that so, that was why lots of people always went to the mathematical studies, and never went to humaniora because that was dangerous. So there are signs that there are. That the situation there also is deteriorating. Long answer, sorry.
We have time for one short final question, please.
Okay, so that's going to be a little bit of a problem, but I have a little bit of an abstract question, because you're, as a Russian expert, you're probably very familiar with the works of Alexander Solzhenitsyn, and he famously said, looking at the past 100 years of Russia, even back to like the time of the Romanovs and the Tsar, etc., that the Russian soul or the Russian people just aren't ready for democracy or liberal ideas or whatever. Do you think that is ever possible for the Russians to have like a sort of democracy-like nation? You already touched upon this topic.
I witnessed the end of communism. I saw the fear disappearing. I saw a vibrant civil society developing, a free press with all the anomalies that were there, because, you know, as you understand, that just to give one example of freedom of press in the period immediately after the collapse of communism, journalists thought that they had to earn money, so CEOs of enterprises could just buy articles. It was like advertisement. They thought that that was journalism. They didn't know. So there were all kind of anomalies, but there was a real spirit of freedom, of development, of wanting to learn and to change society, and there was a big hope. The problem is that the crooks and criminals won. I mean, let's face it, the Putin regime is a corrupt, crony-driven, it's a bunch of criminals. And as their methods are not, they have nothing in common with democracy, there is no, the people don't have the possibility to do anything. All those people that, these the kind of people who try, I mean, I am amazed that after all those years that are, you can still find people like that. And there are loads of them who are clever, who want to change something, who don't want to leave the country, who want to live in a decent country, etc., etc. So I, there, this just, it's, it doesn't have so much to do with the mentality of the people. It's just it's bad luck with their leaders, and if you lose power to, I mean, let's face it, it was like a dictatorship for 70 years. So everything was stamped out. There was nothing. So there was nothing people could build on. So how can you become a democrat if you don't know what it is? You have to live that life. And, I think that Solzhenitsyn was a very pessimistic guy. He had reasons for that, because he was in the Gulag for ages. And I'm not very optimistic myself, but that has not so much to do with the mentality of the Russians. I mean, for my last book, I spent a couple of weeks in a village 400 kilometers from Moscow. It was delightful. It was delightful. I could speak to everybody. Everybody was completely open. They were completely friendly to foreigners. They were not, you didn't have the feeling that, you know, they were brainwashed or whatever. They were just normal people there who wanted to have decent living. Yes, they would be nostalgic about Soviet times, and when I would tell them then, okay, but now you have a car in front of your house and you have a big TV flat screen. And then she said, yeah, you're right. Yeah, yeah, life changed for the better. I mean, materially speaking, they made a big step. But the problem is that they have the wrong regime. And it doesn't look like they're going to get rid of them anytime soon. So these kind of people are going to end up in jail. And that's a shame.
Well, unfortunately, with those pessimistic notes, you could say we have to end the session. Thank you very much for sharing your insights and your experience.
I hope my English was good enough, because my Russian is better.
Well, maybe next time in Russian. If you are interested in these kind of events, please also check one of the other ones. We have one coming up on China and the current affairs over there, and that will be on November the 1st. Also, if you are interested in current affairs, but then on the transatlantic level, please check our essay competition. You can win a trip to America, to Harvard with that. You have to elaborate on the on what will be the future of geopolitics, transatlantic relations, and especially globalization. There will be a deadline for that on the 25th of November. And next week, we have something completely different, but a program on sustainability and if fishing will be the answer or the threat. Thank you very much for your attendance and also for your sharp questions. And I would like to ask one more big applause for Laura Staring.
If I may, I have one advertisement myself. We have on the 25th, if you are interested in the crackdown on media, then we have on the 25th of October in the Rode Hoed in Amsterdam, we every year we have the October lecture. We started that at the centennial of the October Revolution in 2017. And this year it's the CEO of Medusa, foreign agent, who comes to Amsterdam to talk about press freedom in Russia and where this all will end. So if you're interested, please, there are still tickets available.
And they can find the tickets at the Rode Hoed?
At the Rode Hoed, yes, okay. Yes. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for your attention.